This is CGTN, China Global Television Network.
Connectivity, Hong Kong at the heart of a global network linking Asia and beyond.
Integration, law and order in Hong Kong, that's the bedrock of stability and booming business.
Resilience, the unyielding spirit to press on despite the odds.
Future, it rests with Hong Kong's young generation sowing seeds of change.
Hello and welcome to Hong Kong Story, a special edition of CGTN celebrating the 25th anniversary of Hong Kong's return to China and the birth of the Hong Kong Special Administrative Region. I'm your host, Tian Wei. A quarter of a century ago, the 150-year-long colonial rule in Hong Kong finally came to an end, and the city entered into a brand new chapter. Since then, Hong Kong has gone through big changes. Hong Kong has also become the center of world attention at various times. As a journalist, seeing is believing, but it's also about asking the most important questions, finding the most qualified persons to answer them, and sharing crucial information and stories with the world. So since the handover ceremony in 1997, I'm fortunate, together with generations of reporters, to have this opportunity to cover Hong Kong throughout the decades, its strengths, its challenges, and its resolve. And today, we invited some of them into our studio for the Hong Kong Story. I'm so glad to have the opportunity to introduce my colleagues, Hou Na, who has been covering the legislative side of Hong Kong for several years. Good to see you, Hou Na.
Great to see you here, Tian.
We usually bump into each other in the corridor, but not necessarily having conversations
exactly.
with one another.
Today's a good chance.
Exactly. And also Jingjing Li, who is from the new media department of CGTN. She's been doing a lot of stories about the young people in Hong Kong. Looking forward to hear that as well. Last but not least, we have Yang Chengxi sitting here, the gentleman, who has done several documentaries about Hong Kong recently,
exactly.
Particularly after the recent years' turmoils in Hong Kong. Mm. So I guess you have some different perspectives compared to other reporters. So we are here to bring to you all these stories about Hong Kong. As they say, all the stories are gifts of life. So hopefully, when we bring our stories together, we put together a multifaceted of Hong Kong into one special program. By the way, this special edition is being broadcast live both online and on TV. You can find us on many platforms. You know, I have always wondered, ladies and gentlemen, you know, what when it was your first time going to Hong Kong as a journalist, what was your first impression about that city? You know, as a journalist. Mm-hmm. Chengxi?
Well, the first time I went to Hong Kong as a journalist was actually during the 2019 social turmoil. I've talked to many people who expressed their yearn to return to the prosperity and the development of the city that they've always known. And I can tell countless stories of resilience that I will share later today.
Great. And what about for you, Jingjing? When was your first time?
As a reporter,
yes.
My first time was in 2017, but I went there to cover movie premieres and press conferences, and the city gave me the impression that it's so fun and entertaining.
Yeah, absolutely. Of course, we all went to Hong Kong for shopping years before we covered stories about Hong Kong. But anyway, Hou Na, what about for you?
Well, my very first Hong Kong story is July the 1st, 2012, when Hong Kong marked the 15th anniversary. Well, I attend the flag-raising ceremony at the Bohemia Square, where I see the regional flag flying side by side with the national flag. That's a vivid reminder of the one country, two systems.
I can see the pride you have. I remember it was a big team coming from CGTN, then called the CCTV News in Hong Kong. We were doing a lot of stories. You know, when I think about Hong Kong, fortunately, I had the opportunity to cover Hong Kong even years before its handover to China. It was a very interesting time because China just adopted the reform and opening up policy for two decades. So everyone at that time, 1990s in China, was extremely excited about the rest of the world. And Hong Kong obviously become a huge window for us to see the rest of the world. I still remember, you know, covering Hong Kong by doing the pop songs, you know, especially the song the Oriental Pearl, you know, 东方之珠, 月儿弯弯如海港. I remember that song so well because every time we have to sing. But after that, it was a very interesting time, both with the development on the mainland and in Hong Kong. Mm-hmm. Hong Kong has been providing this huge opportunity as the connectivity hub. Mm-hmm. You know, the hub of transportation, the hub of human resources, the hub of new technologies, and also the hub of trading. As with the backdrop of China, the mainland changing, the role of Hong Kong with the center of connectivity has also been evolving. But you know, over the years, we interviewed together many of those movers and shakers in Hong Kong. I got to go have the opportunity to interview every chief executive when they were the chief executive, and some of them even after they left their post. But every time, no matter they were serving or not, they emphasizing on the word connectivity. Obviously, they know confidence comes from connectivity of Hong Kong. So I want to play this clip, you know, excerpts of my interview with the outgoing Hong Kong SAR Chief Executive Carrie Lam. She has been, over the past four or five years, talking to me six times almost. And every time she emphasized on connectivity, despite the recent challenges of prevention and control policies, many still have a lot of hope of Hong Kong with this connectivity. Also, my talk with Henry Tong, the former Chief Secretary for Administration of Hong Kong. He talked to me, though, about another kind of connectivity in the city, a link between China's traditional and contemporary cultures in Hong Kong and with the rest of the world by developing the West Kowloon Cultural District. It involves, you know, planning, development, operation, and maintenance of the arts and cultural facilities in West Kowloon Cultural District. Take a look.
It is important to remind people that Hong Kong's economic development will have to be very closely integrated with the national development. Mm. You just look at the 8 centers that the central authorities have given us support in the 14 five-year plan. Every of those centers, whether it's International Financial Center, International Trade Center, International Aviation Center, International Innovation and Technology Center, all have a mainland dimension. Mm. Why should we forgo an opportunity of doing even better by integrating into the national development? A lot of companies are still finding ways to invest in the Greater Bay Area and so on, especially after the national security law and with the completion of this exercise to improve the electoral system. I'm sure the business environment will be even better.
Now, China has more than 5,000 years of history. And this 5,000 years, art and culture has always been a part of China. And China is very good at this. So this soft power, we have not been marketing it enough because this is a way to tell the China story. This is a way for the Western world to, for the Western world, for the outside world, to see China's softer part, to see our soft power.
Hmm. Well, that was earlier my conversation with Carrie Lam, the Chief Executive of Hong Kong, and also Henry Tang, who is now running the West Kowloon Cultural District. By the way, you heard about the Forbidden City in Hong Kong, right? And they are now having 500 precious, you know, items never shown to the world. It's amazing. I really want to get there right now. But, you know, we'll leave it for another time. And also how, you know, Hong Kong has become such a connectivity hub about contemporary Chinese art. Use it as a window to the outside world. So it's not only about the culture of China, but also the history of China. Education is an important component about that. That has been realized by many in Hong Kong. Some are extremely outspoken about it, about connecting China history with the young people of the Hong Kong SAR. For example, these two I'm going to show you. Annie Wu is a philanthropist, passionate about education. She's been supporting many young people from Hong Kong as they are to travel and study on the mainland. And also Tang Fei, a principal of Hong Kong's Hung Tu Secondary School, he believes in connecting his students in Hong Kong as they are to the bigger story of a dynamic China.
20 years ago, I mentioned to the first chief executive of Hong Kong, Mr. Tong, I said, we are going through from a post-colonial period into the special administrative region of the People's Republic of China. And I suggested to Mr. Tong, day one, we have to use our education bureau to train our young people to understand the transformation. And they need to understand that they are Chinese, born in Hong Kong, but they have to understand the country is China. And I, at that time, I remember I mentioned to Mr. Tong, if you don't take care of the young people of today, 20 years from now, they will say they are only Hong Kong people. They are not Chinese.
Sometimes we bring our students, especially senior forms students, come back to mainland China to see all kinds of the modern cosmopolitan events or affairs, in not just in Shanghai, maybe. Sometimes I bring our students go to the west of Western China, mainland China, to see the traditional and cultural things, especially minor races areas, to let Hong Kong students know a diversified China, mainland China. Sometimes they think, oh, it is cool, it's cool. Okay, fine. When they feel it is cool, they get the points.
It was cool, actually, many of the tours that the students made. I know, Jingjing, you're going to tell us later about the stories of young people in Hong Kong.
Yes, exactly.
Yeah. So, you know, these kinds of connectivity about Hong Kong is something that we are really fascinated about, mm-hmm. and everybody in Hong Kong knows mm-hmm. that. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Yes, exactly. Exactly. Mm. Exactly. Well, I can share a story or two about Hong Kong, because the keyword that I'm bringing to the discussion today is actually resilience.
All right, we're going to hear about that a bit later. Mm-hmm. But you know, about connectivity, Hou Na, what is your understanding of that? 15th anniversary, 25th anniversary, very different when it comes to the backdrop of history.
Exactly, Tian Wei. 10 years ago, when we all together go to Hong Kong to cover the 15th anniversary, and then you feel the city is so vibrant, energetic, stylish. Every good word about it.
Yeah.
And it's different Hong Kong than every nice things you can imagine.
Mm. That's the connectivity that you
definitely.
Feel, you know?
Right.
Yeah. Definitely.
Mm. So we're going to bring us more about the latest development and the mm-hmm. story through the eyes of our reporters. Mm-hmm. We'll be back after this. Mm-hmm. Welcome back. This is Hong Kong's story, our special coverage of the 25th anniversary of Hong Kong's return to China. In the past 2.5 decades, Hong Kong's governance dramatically shifted from colonial rule to one country, two systems. Hou Na, one of our reporters, has been following the evolution of Hong Kong's special administrative region. You have something to tell about that.
Exactly, Tian Wei. As a political correspondent for over 10 years, going to Hong Kong in 2012 to cover the 15th anniversary, I carried my mission with me because I have my questions to ask about the political figures there. Mm. What's Hong Kong like under the one country, two systems? And I get a chance to interview Rita Fansu Lattai. Of course, you've talked to her a couple of times. She was the first president of the Legislative Council, and she sworn in 1997. She witnessed a power transfer back 25 years ago. I talked to her and I went to her office. I follow her to her activities in Hong Kong. I asked her, what's been like 25 years ago? She told me that, of course, before 1997, people have doubts, even questions about Hong Kong's future. And people are wondering what's Hong Kong going to be like after the new dawn. But 15 years later, back in 2012, people have answers, because Rita Fansu Lattai told me that the biggest lesson, what's been like under the one country, two system, is Hong Kong's enduring tradition of freedom and openness. And I talked to her a couple of times back in Beijing, as she is a member of the MPC National Standing Committee, the top legislature, And I talked to her in Beijing a couple of times. She participated actively in the lawmaking process here in Beijing. Well, there are lawmakers like her who are from Hong Kong SAR, who attend the bi-monthly session regularly. Of course, the MPC bi-monthly session was held every two months. And I talked to them about the legislations on Hong Kong. There were a few debates regarding laws and regulations on Hong Kong, especially national security law and the electoral systems, especially the term of patriots administering Hong Kong. Of course, if you look at some of the news and media outlets, when they're reporting news in Hong Kong, people just used to demonize the legislation, especially regarding the basic law, and people saying that Hong Kong has lost its autonomy. But look at what's happening 2 years after the Hong Kong national security law has been implemented. Hong Kong ranked the safest city in the world by the Safe City Index released by The Economist. And that's raised back in 2019, is only ranking the 20th. Yeah. So you can see after the national security law was implemented, law and order has been restored in Hong Kong
society. One could tell you are in full support of that.
Of course.
I can't wait to watch the clip.
Of course. And another good thing is back in 1997, you can see the central government has promised Hong Kong that it will keep the horses racing, as horse race represents the spirit of Hong Kong. And I get a chance to went to Sha Tin Horse Race Court to get to look at how the horses have been running there. Let's take a look.
It's really hard to resist the chance to be a winner. I decided to try my luck today and I bet on number three, $10, to see how it goes.
People say horse racing represents the Hong Kong spirit, taking a chance, savor excitement, and cheering for a winner.
Well, I've got really good luck today because I won 170 Hong Kong dollars, and that could definitely cheer up my day. But horse racing didn't only give people the personal thrill, the influence is far beyond the racetrack. Like the Jockey Club here in Hong Kong is the biggest charity organization in Hong Kong, creating millions of jobs for the city.
The horse racing industry is moving steadily toward the finish line, and winning takes more than just one form. Since the handover in 1997, the Jockey Club, which owns the Sha Tin course, has contributed to more than $17 billion U.S. dollars to charity.
Racing in Hong Kong is far more than just betting. It's really working with the community through good times and bad times. And in terms of sports, our international races is now the World Turf Championship, and we have grown to become one of the top jurisdictions in the world.
The horses have been running in Hong Kong for more than a century. When a horse's ears stand up, it means it's nervous. If a horse is sweating, it might be freaking out. Picking a horse and betting on it has brought joy to so many Hong Kong people. More than winning alone, the essence of the Hong Kong spirit reflected by horse racing is diligence, optimism, and energy. And those qualities mean that for the industry and the city, the odds look very good indeed.
Well, you can imagine, not only the horse has been running, it's been running faster and faster.
I'm glad that I see the confidence that you have about the latest development in Hong Kong. But also, it's amazing to see you 10 years ago. You know, the footage is...
Exactly. I'm wearing short hair and I'm so much skinnier.
So you see, you know, every one of us grow in a way together with the development of Hong Kong and also the interaction between the mainland and Hong Kong.
Yes. You know. Well, I'm quite surprised, not just by the footage from such a long time ago, and also by you. You, just like just said, you developed with the society, with the...
You know, horse racing, I think it represents Hong Kong spirit. Energetic, resilient, as well as vibrant, persistent, every good things you can imagine about it.
You know, when we cover stories, we become part of the story in a way, even though we are not covering about us. But we try to know that place, we try to know the people there, and also we feel like we are one of them.
Yes.
To be able to put ourselves in their shoes and cover the stories about Hong Kong as they are from the point of view of the people in Hong Kong and also from the point of view from the people on the mainland. Yes. It's a very interesting switch of roads from time to time.
Yeah, because when last time I went to Hong Kong, I saw horse racing, and I didn't see a lot of horse racing in the mainland. Uh-huh. But when I was there, my Hong Kong cameraman said that you can actually bet on the horses. Everyone could do that. I was like, you can? Because that is such a symbol of Hong Kong, really, yeah. Was it? Mm-hmm. Because a popular saying at the time, before 1997, was that the horses will still run, and the people will still dance.
Yeah, that and this is shows the prosperity yes. of Hong Kong. I remember going to the horse running race. Actually, I didn't got a chance to get in because it was during the late of night. By the way, boss, we are working very hard around the clock when we're in Hong Kong. So we only saw the outside of the horse racing ring, but at the same time covered the story from inside, yet not be able to be entertained. So you're luckier than most of us.
Well, you know what, Tian Wei, 25 years after, not only did the horses running faster, the Jockey Club, who is a non-profit organization who funded the horse race course, it provided tax revenue worth 25 billion Hong Kong dollars to the central government. So we see it's not only becoming an industry, it's a backbone of the industry.
And the tradition.
Exactly.
The tradition of a city being preserved and also a tradition of a city have also been known to the rest of the world. Mm-hmm. It's so important even also for the younger generation.
Yes, but you know, I've seen this scene that it just showed all of us in different movies while we grew up, because I grew up watching Hong Kong movies, but I haven't been there to actually watch a horse racing. Uh-huh. So after hearing what you said about this, I definitely need to go to Hong Kong again.
The good thing about horse racing is that you can feel the threat of seeing the horse race, running, as well as making a little money out of it. You know?
The Jockey Club are certainly happy about every comment you made. A great promotion for the Jockey Club and certainly for the economy of Hong Kong. We hope in the near future, many of us could travel freely despite of the challenges of the pandemic, and we'll be able to contribute to each other's economy, those from the mainland to Hong Kong and also the other way around. Mm-hmm. It is right now happening, right? I mean, Hong Kong is still trading hub, it is transportation hub, it's going on every day.
Mm-hmm. Yes, and I always feel like I have a very special emotional relationship to Hong Kong because I myself am a Cantonese speaker, a native Cantonese speaker, and I grew up literally watching Hong Kong television.
You were in Canton, right?
Yes, in Zhuhai, very close to Hong Kong. So I was able to pick up Hong Kong TV signals, and I grew up literally watching Hong Kong television. I have a very special emotional bond with Hong Kong, and I've grown up and had the fortune of seeing many facets of Hong Kong, not only just the side that everyone see on the big movies. I know when everyone sees Hong Kong, they always think of, okay, this big international financial center, everyone wearing suit and tie and high heels, walking amongst skyscrapers. And also I get to see another side of Hong Kong, one where people are very hardworking to earn their welfare, to provide for their families. And this is the story that I am planning to tell.
Okay, we're looking forward to that. So you're watching Hong Kong Story, special edition on CGTN, celebrating 25th anniversary of Hong Kong's return to China and the birth of the special administrative region. I'm here with my colleagues to tell our coverage of Hong Kong over the past 25 years. So stay tuned, we'll be back. Connectivity, Hong Kong at the heart of a global network linking Asia and beyond.
Integration. Law and order in Hong Kong, that's the bedrock of stability and booming business.
Resilience, the unyielding spirit to press on despite the odds.
Future, it rests with Hong Kong's young generation sowing seeds of change.
Yes, the Hong Kong Story special edition of 25th anniversary of Hong Kong's return to the motherland and also the birth of the Hong Kong SAR. Through the ups and downs of Hong Kong, including the financial crisis back in 1997, SARS in 2003, and social unrest in the past few years, one of our reporters has been there covering several twists and turns. Yang Chengxi is sitting with us here. You already did your little promo about what you're going to say. Yes. So tell me more about the resilient part of Hong Kong.
Yes, what Hong Kong always impressed me about is the people's resilience. Because as I've said, that Hong Kong might be known for its financial prowess, but the people of Hong Kong really made its name on the world's map by their sheer resilience. Because the city's economy first made its mark back in, I think, maybe the 50s and 60s, when it was founded on the plastics industry, the textile industry, and really through labor, hard work. And the general atmosphere around that time, the spirit among these people was one of resilience. The last time I was in Hong Kong, I interviewed the owner of a cafe which was opened in 1968 and lasted through this day, and she explained to me what that fighting spirit is about. Let's take a look.
Kate Lee runs a cafe at a popular Hong Kong tourist spot. It's a family business since 1968, the year she was born.
香港回歸1994年，我記得我當年應該係一個29歲嘅婦人，有冇心情呢？梗係有啦，我相信係全個香港人都有咯，覺得唔會再寄人籬下。我覺得茶餐廳咧係一個香港嘅一個好有標誌嘅嘢咯。點解會有奶茶咁盛行喺香港呢？ 英國人好興飲奶茶，所以漸漸香港有呢一個盛行咯。係爸爸留落嚟嘅配方，嗰日撈落嚟到現在嘅咁啊。
The cafe, little changed since its inception, has been the backdrop to this family's life for over half a decade. But beyond this tranquil port village, Hong Kong came face to face with a series of crises in the first 5 years after its return. The financial storm that swept Asia in 1997 bankrupted many people in Hong Kong. And in 2003, things went from bad to worse when the SARS outbreak dealt livelihoods in the region another crippling blow.
SARS是2003年農曆新年之後
Despite the pressure, her family kept the business afloat, just as Kate says her parents did during all the hard times they experienced.
他們沒有去過戲院，酒樓飲茶，我想不超過一隻手，五隻手指。爸爸就做餅。
This fighting spirit is something many Hong Kong people pride themselves on. It's best expressed in one of the most widely known songs here, Below the Lion Rock. It celebrates a mountain that overlooks the bustling metropolis, symbolizing the dignity of this city. 人生不免崎岖，难以绝无挂虑。几时同舟在狮子山下且共济，抛弃去奋斗共对。During the 2003 SARS outbreak, the song, played constantly on local radio, became an unofficial anthem of Hong Kong.
我覺得獅子山下精神就係正正係我哋香港人嘅精神。睇熱啊妹，熱啦啦嚇！多謝你帶朋友嚟，多謝，好開心，多謝，好真心多謝，拜拜。
Now, Kate and other Hong Kong people really fought through this hard time with sheer tenacity. But the assistance from the Chinese mainland government also played an important part. Because in 1997, during the financial storm, Beijing backed the Hong Kong Monetary Authority's action to drive out international speculators. And during the 2003 SARS epidemic, the supply of livestock and fresh water, which Hong Kong absolutely relied on from the mainland, remained uninterrupted. But I think one of the most important factors that helped Hong Kong overcome these challenges was the historical decision to open up Hong Kong to mainland tourists back in 2003. And what followed was an influx of mainland tourists who went to Hong Kong to shop for everything from sports shoes to luxury goods. And the effects was immediate. In 2004, Hong Kong's GDP grew by over 8%, ending 68 months of deflation. And it was good news for the Hong Kong's tourism industry, which has been one of the main four pillar industries today.
That's why, you know, all the chief executive of Hong Kong throughout generations have been emphasizing with the big mountains as the mainland,
yes,
or as the central government,
yes,
Hong Kong will be able to prosper. You see the role of Hong Kong vis-a-vis the role of China has been evolving, isn't it?
Yes.
As I said, from the very beginning, it was mainly a window for China and for the world, yes, to China. And yet now China is ever open to the rest of the world, and Hong Kong become part of China that is certainly shining, and yet shining together with other municipalities of China and also some of the fastest developing provinces of China. Greater Bay Area is a great example of that, isn't it, Chengxi?
Yes, because I know for a fact that Kate Lee's little brother, the protagonist that we've seen in the short clip, her brother actually works in Shenzhen, and he told us that it is a great experience working in Shenzhen because Hong Kong people can bring a different set of ideas to the discussions whenever it's developing new products, new services, and it offers great opportunity for the Hong Kong people.
I can tell you got to know every family members of Kate, isn't it?
Well, I talked to her for a long time. Yes, definitely.
So, isn't it? I mean, these human stories are the most shining stories when we are talking about the story of Hong Kong, because it's made of the great people in Hong Kong. Of course, now many of them are traveling on the mainland, working on the mainland, studying on the mainland, the other way around too. So it's a fascinating experience, Jingjing.
Yes. Actually, even in Beijing, I've encountered so many young people from Hong Kong. They chose to study at Tsinghua University, in Peking University. And I wonder why. They said, well, we want to be the bridge to help, well, youngsters in Chinese mainland and Hong Kong to understand each other much better. So I mean, this is a very promising sign.
And they're also saying, you know, China is developing as a whole, including Hong Kong, so fast. So we want to catch up and we want to be the connector. I'm coming back to my keyword, by the way, which is about connectivity, isn't it? So you're watching our special program, Hong Kong Story. We'll be back after this. Welcome back, Hong Kong Story. Now, my colleagues, we bump into each other in the corridor. I never listened to them this length, in fact. I watched your assignment works, your reports, but not, you know, in person. This provides us a great opportunity. And I want to hear your personal thoughts of the stories that you've been doing. Jingjing, for example, about the Hong Kong young people.
Excuse me. So I've been to Hong Kong several times, like for a trip, for tourism, and interacted with many youngsters. And I was convinced that there's a bright and prosperous future ahead of Hong Kong because of these young people. And I want to share two stories with you guys. One is I interacted with several young people, young Hong Kong students after graduation. They didn't choose the job to working in the office, wearing high heels, doing the white collar job. No, instead they moved to a small county in Guangdong province and to be farmers. So they really rented a land and doing experiments for several years because they want to use this way to develop an ecosystem to use the feces of fish to grow vegetables. So, and they failed so many times in growing vegetables in the farmland. So I asked them, why you don't want to do the job, like, you know, the seemingly fancy job, working in the office, but instead you decide to do the hard work in the farmland. They said, because that's what Hong Kong needed the most.
Yes, exactly. I think Hong Kong's former chief executive, CY Leung, told me very similar things when he talked to me about the limited career opportunity in Hong Kong, and maybe that the younger generation in Hong Kong can look forward to a wider range of career choices in the mainland, because this is actually what he said to me. Imagine that you're holding a certificate from the Hong Kong University of Science and Technology, which is a very great university, of their astronomical astronomy degree. And what can you do after your graduation in Hong Kong? You're probably going to study for an MBA and become a business person. But you don't have to do that. If you look for bigger opportunities in the mainland, you can work in the aerospace industry in the bigger home country.
You know what, under the Greater Bay Area scheme, you can even work in the government, I mean the Hong Kong youngsters. Because we have a special zone in Qianhai in Shenzhen and Nansha in Guangzhou, they provided government positions, government officials positions to the Hong Kong youngsters.
So certainly it's a bigger and brighter horizon and provide them as much more opportunity.
Yeah, it's actually with a lot of policies because to rent a large piece of land and do farm work in Hong Kong is almost impossible for them. But in Guangdong, there are so many policies from the local government that really support them. They can use very small amount of money and rent a large piece of land and do the experiments. And they want to bring the fresh vegetables to Hong Kong to support the locals. And actually, I want
to taste some of their vegetables. How was it?
Because it's very organic.
Oh, good.
It's very organic from the and you can taste the fish as well. So it's a fish and a vegetables. So I mean, simple stuff like this vegetables. Like Hong Kong's never short of material stuff, but it's some simple thing like fresh vegetables is something they needed the most. And another story about young people is actually because I encountered a lot of young people of my age born in the 80s, and this year in March, they were successfully being elected as legislator. So many of them stepped into the political field. And they were born and raised in Hong Kong. They came to Chinese mainland several times. They know the culture, language here as well. And they also lived and studied in Western countries before. So a very common thing about them is they're young, they know Cantonese, Mandarin, English, they know different cultures very well. And they said, asked them why you want to be like politicians, legislators. They said, especially we know what happened in 2019. And they said, well, after seeing that, as young people, as young Hong Kongers, we think we need to step in and make our city, our country much better. And literally they said, as Chinese born and raised in Hong Kong, I think if there were problems, it should be solved by us, but by ourselves, not by some foreign forces. So they want to make the city much better, and many young people like them and want to make policies, make Hong Kong much better, and also make opportunities, windows, bridges among young people in the Chinese mainland and in Hong Kong. So
it's amazing what you have just told me, because it's about as long as you have big dreams, your stage is going to be big, because Hong Kong has become part of China after 25 years, right, of development. And, you know, think about all these possibilities. One, the legislative change, and also about the Greater Bay Area, about the young people having a bigger experiment ground in a way about their life with the support of the central government and also the local policies from different part of China. So how do we see, you know, as a reporter, how do you see where Hong Kong is? And I wonder recently whether you have contacted some of those who interviewed earlier throughout the years. I really want to know about this.
I think social stability is definitely the key to all economic development, because we have the national security law, which was in place like in 2020, but actually China had our own national security law back in 1993, and it's in place until 2014 when the country's counter-espionage law was passed, and then we have the new in 2015, we have the new national security law. And then after 2019, social unrest in Hong Kong, the central government and the top legislature began amending on the new Hong Kong version of the national security law. And if some of Western media say that it undermines the autonomy of Hong Kong, just say in the United States, we have over 20 pieces of legislation regarding national security, and namely a few, the Espionage Act of 1917 and the National Security Act of 1947. Why can the United States have their own national security law? Why cannot China have our own national security law?
Right. Well, of course, a lot of these political debates, we see those debates being covered throughout the 24 hours program of CGTN. You know, before we go, I really want to know, you know, on a lighter note, where would you love to travel to Hong Kong if we got the opportunity in the near future? Because we saw the latest prevention control policies have been changing. So bigger hope to travel faster, right? So let's start from Jingjing.
Okay, so I think before this, every time I went to Hong Kong, I always do one thing, is go to a place that I saw in an iconic Hong Kong film and take the exact scene that's been shown in the film and take like pretend I'm the actress, leading actress, so there. So last time I went to the Mong Gok station and to also took photo with the minibus, because there's a horror film that people vanishes with the minibus.
Yes.
So I took selfie with the minibus. So next time, I still haven't went to the Chongqing Mansion because of the Chongqing Express, the movie. So next time I will go there.
Right. Well, I can tell a movie fan is right here. What about for you, Chengxi?
Well,
to that cafe again?
Well, I definitely want to go to the top of the of the Lion Rock because, as you've seen in the clips that I've shown, we've shown very good drone shots over it.
Yeah.
But I've always wanted to go there myself because trekking up mountains is a big culture in Hong Kong.
How long will that take, you know, to get there?
Maybe several hours. It's good exercise, and I definitely need it because I want to lose weight, because obviously.
Sure you're gonna have enough time.
Yes, yes, and I always want to go on top of the Lion Rock and look across Hong Kong, and I'm sure it would be a very emotional moment for me.
I know you're gonna meet many of the Legislative Council members, given your earlier comments, but besides that,
I want to go to the Central for shopping. Of course, the shopping list is ready in place. And then I want to go to the Sha Tin horse race court again, because I really want to feel the threat of seeing horses running again.
Right, that's terrific. Make sure to bring all of us with you as
of
well.
Of course.
That. But having said that though, you know, I really want to visit my friends in Hong Kong. I miss them so much. The friends that I met 25 and even 27 years ago, and we've been keeping in touch with one another. We've been through the ups and downs together, just as Hong Kong together with the rest of China. And I guess with that friendship, with that personal warmth, you know, we will be able to get there no matter how big our dream is. So besides that, I also want to go to, you know, the Forbidden City in Hong Kong and also see the exhibitions of contemporary Chinese art.
That will be
great collection over there. So I hope we'll be able to make the trip together very soon, hopefully.
Definitely.
Yes, on that note, I want to thank every one of you to be with me here today on this very special edition of our program for the Hong Kong story with the blossom of the beautiful bohemian flowers. Some of them even show on the flags of Hong Kong. We are wrapping up today's special program. Thank you so much for being with us. Bye for now.